Good morning, men. Welcome back. Well, this is the final wrap-up as we wrap up the Dad's Armor study. We've talked about a lot of things over the last few weeks, and I hope that it's provided some great insight. We talked about heritage, our Father's heritage, and taking ownership and turning heart under the heritage of our Heavenly Father. We talked about the heart and the things that are all about distracting us, the busyness, how we're to accept responsibilities and nurture the most important relationships that we have on this earth, our relationship in marriage and family. And that's all tied to how grounded we are in our relationship with Jesus Christ. And most recently, we talked about the home, how we're to protect the house and stand firm, to clean the house and lead in the way. You know, that's our challenge, and that's our marching order, is to make sure that our home and that we're raising a godly generation as a function of how we manage our home. Put on the full armor of God. Ephesians 6:10 through 17 states it very clearly. We're to take our stand against the devil's schemes. What are the devil's schemes? Well, they're very personal. He knows your game plan, and he's coming after you. So whether that scheme, whatever tastes good, feels good, looks good, you might make sure that it is of God and not of the devil, because his schemes can be pretty conniving to distract us. Stand firm with the belt of truth buckled around your waist. Men, you know, we're built with a gut feel for things when they're just not right. Whenever you get that gut feel, be sure to calibrate it to the Word of God and make sure that you're going in the right direction. We're blessed with that, but we need the belt of truth, which, of course, truth is the Word of God, and we have to stay grounded in that as we respond to our gut feel. Years ago, I had a dad confess that he did not like a young man that his daughter was dating, but his wife kept saying, well, he's a handsome young man, he's a good young man, and everything's good, and there's not any problem, and he didn't follow up on his gut feel. And in tears, he shared with us how his daughter was date raped in the basement of that young man's family home. And he just convicted us that you have a gut feel of what's going on, particularly with your daughter. Run the traps. Look in the truth and make sure that your gut feel, that you act on that if that's what needs to be done. Look at the breastplate of righteousness in place. We talked a lot about the heart and the things that work to distract us from the most important relationships in this world, our relationships in marriage and family. So we have to get those things under control, the busyness, being under Satan's yoke. These are the things that we have to rebuke, and putting that breastplate of righteousness guards our heart and makes sure that we stay focused on the right priorities, not on the performance of this world, but in the relationships, our relationship with Jesus the Christ, how we live that in marriage and reflect that in family. Having the feet fitted with the readiness of the gospel of peace. That's the call. That's in our home. We talked about that last week, that getting the gospel into our home, both in the things that are coming into our home and in your leadership in the home, it's critical to convey that gospel. Have those feet fitted and ready to dance around any other distractions, to rebuke the other distractions that come into your home. And finally, put that helmet of salvation. We talked about that the first week. That salvation that is our heritage of our Heavenly Father, that we're a son of the Most High God. That's the salvation we can claim, that through the life, the death, and resurrection of Jesus the Christ, we are an heir of God and a co-heir with Jesus the Christ. That's the salvation we should walk boldly in and claim, and certainly pass on to the next generation at every opportunity. We put on the shield of faith with extinguishing those arrows. Man, those arrows are going to come in. Have that shield lifted high and extinguish those arrows before they penetrate the armor or catch an area that's not covered possibly. But there's not going to be an area not covered if you have the full armor on. And that's what you're called to do is across these weeks together. And finally, he says to put the sword of the Spirit. This is the Word of God. You know, that's what we operate in. You remember the story of Peter cutting off the ear of the Roman guard, you know, and Jesus said, put up the sword, Peter. This isn't what this is about. We're about the Word of God. and he had to continue his journey and kept his warrior in check. You know, we're warriors for God. Our sword of the Spirit is the Word of God as we navigate through life. And finally, pray on all occasions. Pray on all occasions. If you take nothing else from our time together, I always encourage prayer for our children and our wives every day by name. I have a prayer guide in the book to reference as you can, and just draft a very personal prayer that you'll be praying for each of your children each day. The only reason I'm here, man, is because my mother prayed for me every day through some pretty deep valleys and areas that I'm sure she didn't like me very much, but I knew she loved me unconditionally. And that's what we're called to do, to pray. Your armor should be dented, bloodied, tarnished. God wants to know that He's had a warrior in you in this world. You know, we have to be stand firm for what we believe in. There's a lot of forces out there, a lot of evangelism going on for secularism in this world, for what your kids are learning in school and what they're being exposed to just across the airwaves. We have to be at least as aggressive to evangelize in our faith and our relationship with Jesus the Christ, to get the gospel of peace out there. So when we draft our battle plan, you wonder, why do I need to draft a battle plan? Well, you need to because the devil's got one against you. So if you don't draft a battle plan, you're just kind of waffling around out there and you're easy pickings. So I encourage you to look on page 29 and 30 and draft a first pass of what this battle plan is going to look like. On page 28, you have a development of the battle plan in which I want you to write through right now as we're talking. What are your strengths? What areas? What would you consider your strengths on these respective battlefronts for your heritage, your heart, and your home? What are your weaknesses? Are you vulnerable in any particular areas? That's the next area. You're particularly vulnerable in the area of whatever. Maybe it is the computer. If it's a computer at 10 o'clock, after 10 o'clock at night, shut down the computer at 9 o'clock. If it's going to the gym, stop going to that gym. If it's watching football 18 hours a weekend, then let's turn off the television. You know, these are things that are taking you away from what the right priorities are. And identify what you need help with. Do you need some accountability? And finally, write down there what you commit to. And page 29 and 30 is the first pass of your battle plan. I want you to decide right, you know, as between now and over your small group time, what will you claim when it comes to your heritage? Will you claim the spirit of sonship under the Abba Father? You know, that's I want you to claim that and have that as part of your battle plan. What about your heart? What will you prioritize? Will you prioritize your personal, passionate, and growing relationship with Jesus the Christ and learning to love as He loves in your marriage? You know, those are things that I want you to kind of look at and see what needs to be prioritized a little bit differently than what you had prioritized a few weeks ago. How about your home? You will step up in what way? Will you step up as the Josiah of your home? Will you step up as a leader, one that's taken them to church? Will you step up as a volunteer to run a small group for your youth director? You know, what will you do to step up your game in your home? And finally, you'll establish accountability with someone. What name that person. Maybe it's in your small group here. I will commit to weekly fellowship. You know, those are the things that may be a little bit different than what you had planned on before this study started. So work through that battle plan on page 29. That's a draft, and then finalize it on page 31. And what I'd like you to do there is have members of your small group here, your discussion group, sign off on it so you guys can hold each other accountable and continue this study separately and one-on-one. In summary, the key battlefronts are your heritage, heart, and home. Man, these are battlefronts the devil has notched victories in for a long time. It's time to kick some devil tail. And you can do that because, again, you have the power of the resurrected Christ and the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. And so you can do. You have what it takes. You are good enough. And you can do whatever the Lord puts on your heart to do, to lead the way for your family. As we wrap up this study, man, I want to share one of my favorite clips. I don't want you to get hung up on the spirituality, but this is from the movie Michael. And it's the last scenes where Michael faces off against the bull.
Eventually, it was transported here. There is enough twine to stock 5,000 hardware stores.
Can happen, you know. Trust me.
Michael!
No fret.
Equipment! Michael! Michael! What are you doing?
I am completely happy.
Are you all right? Do you feel your legs?
No injury. 6,360 battles.
Can you sit up?
Of course I can sit up.
I have no idea how they got that bull to sit down like that. But did you hear, Michael? 6,360 battles, no injuries. Men, in this world, we're going to get knocked on our backside. That means that you're in the battle. But your charge is to get up. There's a generation dependent on you. Don't let the world knock you down and keep you down. Get back up. Get in the battle with the full suit of armor on. Men, you're now faithful fathers, standing firm on these battlefronts we've discussed. I challenge you to continue to make sure your armor of God is, you're fully suited up and you're boldly stepping onto the battlefield. That's the dad you're called to be, and that's the dad the next generation needs. Lord, I thank you for this time together again. What a blessing it is to see the commitment in this room, and I know that the devil is nervous. Thank you, Lord, for the power of you resurrected and the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. May we never shy away from the battle, but boldly step forward with all the confidence that is our personal, passionate, growing relationship with you. Lord, we thank you for our marriages. I ask you, Lord, right now to keep your hedge of protection around each marriage, each family represented in this room, and that you would just be who you are and do what you do. Give each man the clarity, the discernment, the boldness, the confidence to move forward as the faithful father. A dad that prioritizes physical presence, is engaged emotionally, and leads spiritually by example. Lord, that's the father you call us to be, and that's the dad the next generation needs. Let me close with the prayer over the Israelites. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. And Lord, we understand that peace and the most expressive, shalom in its most expressive form is not the absence of war, but the positive state of rightness and well-being in the midst of the battles. Equip each man to face the battles well. Lift this up in the powerful name of Jesus the Christ. Amen.